I don't want to be knocking on that door too early. I mean, how would you like to appear in heaven, knocking on heaven's door? Can you could you even imagine, Lord, we're not ready for you yet. What would be worse is, you're not ready for here yet. Oh, wait a second. You understand now why I don't want to knock on heaven's door early. Are you with me this morning? I don't want to knock on that door early. Paul said that to live is Christ, but to die is gain. And the word Christ has with it the thought and the meaning of a suffering sacrifice. To live is Christ. Sometimes, and many times in our lives, we will be living a life where it's necessary for us to suffer. Amen? Jesus had told us that this world, in this life, you're going to suffer. You're going to have trials. You're going to have tribulations. But we read in the scripture, and one of the things he said, of course, like, be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. And we read in the scripture that all things work together for good. And many times in our lives, we're going to experience things, and at the moment we're experiencing, I can't really see any good in this. This morning, when I have this privilege to share once again about a resurrection, the resurrection of the Redeemer, there was some suffering that went on. Yes, Jesus suffered and he died. But to all those that knew him, all those who loved him, they suffered, they mourned, they grieved. Can I tell you this morning that Jesus says to you today, don't be like those who have no hope. He's saying to you today, he says, listen. Though you might die, yet shall you live. Why? Because I am alive. Can you hear that this morning? Jesus saying, I am alive. Would you just lift your hand to heaven and say, Jesus, we recognize that you are the living God, the living Savior, that God too come to redeem us. And speak to the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, come. Come and comfort us. Come guide us. Come give us the hope. Carry on in Jesus' name.
Yeah. sweet it is to trust in Jesus. Oh, how sweet it is to trust in Jesus. Oh, how sweet it is to trust in Jesus.
Son of God, have mercy on me, and sinner.
Hey, brother.
Step right up to that microphone.
Step right up to the microphone.
There you go.
All right. Lord Jesus, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. There is a voice of rebellion deep in the heart of the wicked.
There is no fear of God before his eyes.
He flatters himself in his own eyes.
That his sinful sin will not be found out.
The words of his mouth are wicked and deceitful.
He has left off acting wisely and doing good.
He thinks of wickedness upon his bed and has set himself in no good way.
He does not abhor that which is evil.
Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God,
have mercy on me, a sinner.
Say it again.
Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner.
Stand in your love, my fear. It doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love, my fear. It doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love, my fear.
Can you give the Lord a hand clap of praise? Hallelujah. I don't know what you came to do, but I came to praise the Lord. I know it's tough for some of us, but here's the thing. Open up your mouth and sing. Lift your hands to heaven. If you feel like it, do some dancing. I told someone the other day, listen, if I get up and dance with what I've been going through lately, can I tell you that is a sign of God. And listen, the healing power, the delivering power, the freeing power of the Holy Spirit in my life. I'm looking forward to once again dancing, not only just in the spirit, certainly not in my mind, but in this body. Come on now. Some of us, we're just willing to sit, soak, and sour. We're willing just to sit down and just suffer. But my God says, get up and praise me. My God says, I have enabled you to do all things. And it is my Son that strengthens you. Would you lift your hand to heaven under the power of the Almighty and say, God, thank you for the strength to go on. Thank you for the hope that keeps giving me the desire to continue to live and to serve you and my fellow man. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah.
Mercy never fails me, and all my days.
Put your hands together for him. Hallelujah. Go ahead and turn the lights on and give everybody an opportunity to, if you have your offering, if you've got it, great. If you haven't got it ready, we're going to give you just a few moments. And open your Bibles while you're at it to the book of John. Isn't that a good book to open up to? The Gospel of Jesus. Amen? The book of John. And just to be clear, we're not done worshiping today. Are you hearing what I'm telling you? We do our best, like Amanda and the boys, they do their best to set a foundation, to bring you into a mindset and a spirit of praise, if you will, worship. And this is another act of our worship. And I'm going to say this, and then we're going to pray. Of course, you know that we have some absentees today, but we also have some lovely ladies here visiting. Glad to have you with us. Amen.
Amen.
And just when it's all over, we hope that you were glad that you came.
Already are.
Already are. Hallelujah.
Amen.
All right. Just wait. I haven't preached yet. I want to just share something with you in the idea of what we do during a time like this. When we give the offering. And then we're going to be teaching after Pentecost, we'll be teaching about some of these things, about our offerings, about the sacrifice that we bring, and you know, what they all mean, and about tithing, because there seems to be a little bit of a controversy quite often with the believers about the idea of tithing. But I never have had any problem with it. I'll just say this. I didn't do it in my early days in church because nobody ever taught me about it, really. Preacher would get up, or an elder would get up, or somebody would read some scripture. That sounds pretty good. And we'd throw a dollar or two here and there to play, thought we did good. But I learned later on there's a principle. And we could talk about the principle of loaves and fishes and things like that. So we could talk about planting a seed and things like that. But here's the thing. One of the things that I believe about tithing, first off, it's not a gift. You are not giving God a gift when you tithe. It's not a gift. Neither should it necessarily be seen as an obligation. But I will tell you this, it is a token, in a sense, of appreciation. And you think about this, because through the scriptures, nowhere does it say that, hey, no, listen, Jesus came and, well, I haven't found this yet. If anybody know this verse, Jesus says, hey, listen, we're not tithing anymore. I don't see him saying that. So if Jesus didn't say it, the principle still remains. Did you hear that? The principle remains. The principle, the spirit of the idea of tithing still stands. And many times, if you think about what was happening, you know, if we look at it from the law of Moses, or you know, the law from the Old Testament, which many people say it doesn't exist. If you read in the Bible, you'll find out that you have the law of Moses. And there's a story we'll be preaching in the future too. You've heard it before, but there's a story where there's a man who died. He was wealthy, and he just wanted another one who had died that was poor to come and bring him a drink of water, just a drop of water, just to cool his tongue. And he was told, hey, we can't do that. There's a great gulf between them. There's a separation. Nobody, once you're there, nobody can cross over. You're there. There is no coming back, and there's no coming to you. And so this rich man says, then send Lazarus to go tell my family. And here's what the response was. If you will not believe the law of Moses, neither will they believe in the resurrection of the dead. Bring it forward to where we're at right now, the resurrection of the Redeemer. There are many of us who still need to understand, and I'm getting ahead of myself a little bit, but I'm kind of laying the foundation. We're having a difficult time really appreciating the fact that though he were dead, he lives. He died, yet he lives. I serve a risen Savior. He is in the world today. Amen. Now, some people, I think that's crazy. If he listen, if you're not in a, you listen, if you're not in a relationship with Jesus like this, if you don't have this kind of relationship with Jesus, you might want to question your place. Remember what I said at the opening of the service? I don't want to come knocking on heaven's door too soon. Not so much that they're not ready for me, because Jesus says, hey, I'm going away to prepare a place for you. I think he's ready for me. But I don't want him to open up that door and say, oh, you're not ready. When it comes time for me to be at that door, I want to be ready. Not only do I want to be ready, I want everyone that knows me to get that opportunity to be ready when that day comes. Amen. Would you pray with me? Father God, in the name of Jesus, we just praise your name. We thank you, God, for the gifts that we have received. First and foremost, the gift of life. The forgiveness of sins, healing for our bodies, hope for the future. Thank you, God, for all the abundance that we have in you. And now today we give our tithes and our offerings, all of which are just a token of what you give to us. And Father, we give, Lord. We give to the church, we give to the children's home, and more importantly, Lord, we give in the name of Jesus, that you might be blessed and that you might multiply the blessing of our giving. You gave so much, we can't give what you gave. But Lord, I offer my life. Say it with me, church. Lord, I offer my life as a living sacrifice. Amen, amen. So this morning I want to share a word with you from the book of John, the Gospel of John. And the book of John, as we have taught here the last few months now, the importance of this particular book and why it is that it stands alone amongst the four Gospels, the first three being Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Matthew, Mark, and Luke, just to remind you, they tell about Jesus. They tell about his birth. They tell about his life. They tell about the miracles that he did. They tell about his suffering. They tell about his dying. They tell about his resurrection. They tell all about all the things that he did. But the book of John focuses on something else. The book of John is more of a portrait, if you will, word pictures of who he is. We get to see, I get to look at him through the precious word of God, this wonderful picture, if you will, of the Son of God. And that's what I hope to do this morning, is once again to continue as we're speaking and studying and considering the resurrection of Jesus. Because there is so much, I think, we miss out on when we don't recognize the significance of this. First off, if there is no resurrection, the Bible says that our faith is in vain. Did you hear that? Well, then someone would say, well, I'm having a little trouble really comprehending and believing in the resurrection. What will happen if at the end of my life I still have trouble? Well, here's the thing. Did you know that you can live a Christian life and still have a good life? Not believing in the resurrection. But I have to tell you, we have to have confidence in this resurrection. We cannot doubt this important aspect of our Christian faith. Amen? Let's read John chapter 20. We're just going to read these verses. Follow along with me if you would, if you could. Beginning in verse 1. Now the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early while it was still dark. And she saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. And then she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved and said to him, they have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him. Peter therefore went out, and the other disciple, and they were going to the tomb, and so they both ran together, and the other disciple outran Peter and came to the tomb first. And he, stooping down and looking in, saw the linen clothes lying there, yet he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb, and he saw the linen clothes lying there, and the handkerchief that had been around his head, not lying with the linen clothes, but folded together in a place by itself. And then the other disciple who came to the tomb first went in also, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not know the scripture that he must rise again from the dead. Then the disciples went away to their own homes. Verse 11. But Mary stood outside by the tomb weeping. And as she was weeping, she stooped down and looked into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and the other at the feet, where the body of Jesus had lain. And then they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" And she said to them, "Because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they laid him." Now when she had said this, she turned around and she saw Jesus standing there, and did not know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom do you seek?" She, supposing him to be the gardener, said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." And Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him, "Rabboni," which is to say teacher. And Jesus said to her, "Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father. But go to my brethren and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and to your Father, and to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord and that he had spoken these things to her. Father, we pray this morning as we have read your holy text, your precious word, that God, that our ears have been open and attuned, and our minds have been attentive, and our hearts have received what you have spoken. Father, I pray, Lord, for the anointing this morning, that God, that you would give your manservant the wisdom, and that God, as I stand in the shadow of the cross, under the shadow of your wing, that, Lord, that you would guard this man to not do your word no harm, but to say it exactly as you would have it said, that it would go out and do what it's sent to do, in Jesus' name. And those who want to receive a blessing from Christ said,
"Amen."
So today, we're looking into this precious Word of God. And as we look at this, we see some events that are taking place. It's a wonderful picture of events that took place, a wonderful picture of Christ. You know, over the last few weeks, actually the last couple of months, many of us would have to admit that we've gone through some difficult times, losing within our own little congregation two precious souls from being in fellowship with us here. And I know we get some comfort and some consolation to say to be absent from the body is to be present with God. Amen? To be present with him, to be present with the Lord. There is some comfort and there is consolation in that. But nevertheless, we understand that it's also okay for us to mourn and to grieve the fact that someone who was with us will not be with us again. The idea, of course, if this one, if a loved one is saved, if they know Christ as their Savior, and they've been serving him throughout whatever time they served him, when we go there, we'll meet them there again. Amen? We're not to be like those who have no hope. Amen? So when we look at this, we see through all this, through the time of Easter, the resurrection, from Good Friday to resurrection, we celebrate that great truth that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who was crucified on a Roman cross, that he died and he arose from the dead 3 days later. And John paints us a word picture, if you will, of Jesus. Jesus, the resurrected Redeemer. Amen? So the truth is what sets Christians apart from every other system and belief in the world. All other religions have leaders. And they've all died. Buddha died. Muhammad dead. Confucius dead. Every founder of every religion that ever existed has died, but only one has ever come out of the grave alive. Can you say amen? Would you give him a hand clap of praise? You see, if Jesus did not arise from from the dead and is not alive today, then everything that he did, all the works he did, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and all the things that he did, his death was a waste of life, and all of his teaching was simply teaching and maybe even ravings of a madman. Without that resurrection of Christ, Christianity is just another dead religion. And if Jesus Christ is not alive, we have no salvation. There is no hope for the world. And we are all headed to hell. But he's alive. Amen. Did you hear what I said? He's alive. Amen. He's not dead. He's alive. He died, but he didn't stay dead. He arose on that third day just as he said he would do. And I want you to see some things here. I want you to notice in this particular word picture, if you will, in this story, the portrait of the resurrected Redeemer today. Look at the characters in this portrait. One of the first characters that we recognize here is a woman by the name of Mary. We see her in those first 11 verses. And there are some things about her I want you to realize. This is Mary, not Mary the mother of Jesus. This is Mary Magdalene. You might say she had a past. She had a history. But here is Mary. Jesus had done some things for her in her life. And there's always hope, but we really never have hope until it's been revealed to us. And on this day, it would be a day of discovery for Mary. Amen? Mary came to the tomb. It was still long before sunup. It was still dark. And when she arrives, she finds that the stone had been rolled away and the tomb empty. What does she do? Immediately, she runs away. But she runs to find the disciples of Jesus, and she tells them that the body of the Lord is missing from the tomb. He's gone. He's not there. When they heard the news, Peter and John, they got up immediately and they ran to the tomb to see for themselves. Turn to your neighbor and say, to some seeing is believing. When they arrived, they both saw something inside the tomb. They looked in there, they saw the linen clothes, they were lying there, they were undisturbed, and they saw the napkin that had been around his face was left there all by itself, folded nice and neatly. Now the Bible says that the linen clothes were lying wrapped together, still entwined, just as if they had first been put in there when they wrapped Jesus' lifeless body. They just laid there in a pile, and the burial spices would have hardened the cloth, And the body would have formed a cocoon, but that cocoon, that wrapping was vacant. It was empty. Amen? Now, had the body been taken out by robbers, the wrappings around the body would have likely been removed or taken with. They would have not been left in the fashion that they were. And then there was the matter of that napkin, the one that was on his face. Had the body been removed by others, the napkin would have merely been laying, maybe had fallen right wherever it lay, and instead it had been folded and laid in a place all by itself. Nice and neat. Everything speaks of calmness and order in this empty tomb of Jesus. It wasn't as if there was a ruckus. It wasn't as if there were some robbers that busted in and stole the body. It's as if Jesus, who had died, just got up and left. So that's the picture that we see. We see this discovery of the Savior who's gone. Now, at this point, she's not sure what to make of it. The disciples really don't know what to make of it. Now, you might know if you've read your Bible, you've been in church a while, you know that he told them what was going to happen. On the third day, I'm out of here. I'm like, well, on the third day, I'm going to rebuild the temple. He also told them that it was necessary that he would die. They didn't want to believe that either. But all these things came to pass. What if I told you whatever Jesus says is true, and it will happen as he says? Could you believe that? So here again, we're looking at her discovery. She got to discover something. The one whom she loved, this Savior, this teacher, Rabboni, the teacher, is gone. He was dead, but now his body's gone. Notice, she doesn't know he's alive. Now we also see in her character, we see her devotion in verse 11. It says that John and Peter had run away from the tomb, but Mary stayed behind. And she wept and she mourned for the loss of her Lord. Why did she stay there? Why did she linger? I know some of you are just bored with this story. I can tell by the looks on your faces. Why did she linger? Because she loved him. She loved Jesus. The Bible tells us that Mary had been delivered from a life of deep, dreadful sin. She loved Jesus for what he had done for her. She was devoted to him for the things he had done for her. You see, here's what I'm telling you today. And you need to listen to this very carefully. Because the soul that has been redeemed will not allow himself or herself to be distracted from the one that redeemed him or her. The soul that has been redeemed will love the Savior and not allow anything else to distract them. We are so easily turned away, so easily distracted. I have said this for years. It took years for me to get into the smartphone thing. I mean, my first one was a Crackberry. My daughters were calling it a Crackberry, and I found out why. Because next thing you know, here you are. 2 o'clock in the morning. 3 o'clock in the morning. 6 o'clock. Oh, man, I've got it. Some of us need to realize what's going on. We are addicted to these things. You know, and my grandmother, when we came to her house and it was time to go to the table, I couldn't bring my little toy soldiers. I couldn't bring my trucks. And I surely couldn't bring my pet squirrel to the table. But many of us, we have made everything out to be, there's nothing sacred. Did you hear what I'm saying? Everything becomes ordinary. Nothing sacred, including the house of God, your place with God. There's nothing sacred. See, because when things are sacred, you protect those things. You keep them that way. So the soul that's been redeemed will love Jesus. This woman loved Jesus. And she loved everything about the things he did and the things that he was. And she didn't quite comprehend why he had to leave. And so she's there and she's mourning and she's weeping over the fact that this one whom she loved is gone. Now when you stop to think of all that he's done in your life, how could you not love him? How is it that you can sit in your life, go through life, and let yourself be distracted? Maybe we need to go back to the old days in church. Although I don't think the Church of God was ever like this, but we don't allow ourselves to be distracted by the things that are going on. Children were brought into the sanctuary, and listen, I know some of them were allowed to lay under the pews, some of them, But in modern society, no, we take the children out of the sanctuary. And some of you have been guilty of this, where you reject the children from the presence of God in the sanctuary, and you've taught them for years not to be respectful, not to be reverent, not to make the sanctuary holy. Well, it's just another room. It's just a building. I could get off on another story, but we're not going to right now, because in the Old Testament, you find many examples where they erected a place to worship. And each person had something to do with something else that was sacred. But today we're talking about that which is greatest, that makes everything else holy. His name is Jesus. When you think about this, what has Jesus done in your life? How could you not love him? And why do you find it so difficult to obey him? He says, if you love me, then do what I say. Now, he's not trying to manipulate us, and neither am I trying to manipulate. I'm just telling you, this is what the Word of God says. If you love him, you will obey him. Amen. Now, Mary, she sets the right example of love and devotion for all the followers of the Lord Jesus. Those two men, what did they do? They went back. What did it say they did? They left the tomb, went back to wherever they came from. I think I'd be more like Mary myself. See, the question that comes to mind this morning is, do we love him as we ought to? Do we love Jesus as we ought to? Many Christians, I'll say believers, who say they believe upon Jesus, they don't love him and his church any more than, actually they love him less than their favorite country singer. Let me move on, because I think I've illustrated, and she illustrates her devotion to Jesus. Amen? Amen. But then there was this darkness. She's there. She's looked into the tomb. She's crying, mourning, weeping. Mary had her eyes focused on this physical evidence rather than on the spiritual answer. All she saw was an empty tomb. You know, it probably really never entered her mind to consider the greater truth that Jesus was alive. Many times we see things and we take it at face value and we jump to conclusions. I mean, many Christians live as if they believe that Jesus was dead. That he suffered and he died on the cross and he took my sins away. And many of us, even here this morning, there's no joy, there's no excitement in the lives of many who believe, but don't believe properly. You see, there's so many who have no deep desire to worship and to serve the God who sought us and bought us by his love with his death on the cross. Seriously, week after week, month after month, and year after year, we stand on the front, and I need to wear some pom-poms and a tutu to try to get you to worship. You need a cheerleader to get your mouth open. Stop. And you know what? God said, stop it. If they don't love me, they don't think. I get it. It's on them. But that's not what my desire is. My desire is that all people will. Wait a second. That's his desire. That all would come to the knowledge of Jesus. Amen. I can't tell you how many times. Brother William, this ain't about you. I can't tell you how many times that during a service I needed a potty break. Oh, no, 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 no. I ain't, no, I'm holding it. I'll let everything else out, but I am not going to withhold my worship of Jesus. Amen. I'm not making light of it. That's how it is quite often. Do you have that deep, burning desire? You know, we often act as if we're trapped in some sort of, well, some dead religion that kills our joy and leaves us feeling miserable. Those who should be Christian, let me remind you this morning that we serve the very one who went to Calvary, died for our sin, and 3 days later, he arose from the dead, and he lives forevermore. Amen. Oh, come on. Some of you know this. I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy. I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. I almost wanted to dance right there. Amen. As I think about the fact that yet he died, but he is alive. And he's alive forevermore. He's in the world around us. And I'm just going to make this statement again. If all you see is darkness and doom and gloom in this world, that means you're still in darkness even to this point.
Amen.
I'm not saying that it's not a bad place. Jesus said this is a rough place to be. As a matter of fact, one commentary I read about Jesus, and he left the tomb and he folded his napkin right there. He said, I really didn't enjoy my stay here. But he loved being here. Welcome to the Hotel Hallelujah. Amen. So we see Mary, she's there in the scene, and now there's a couple of other entities that appear on the scene, some folks that we talked about in verses 12 and 13. You've got a couple of entities called angels. These angels that are there, they were there, and they were what? They were present. So here they are, here's their presence. There were two angels at the tomb. These angels, they came, they actually, God had sent these two angels. They were dispatched from God. How many of you right now could use one angel?
Amen.
Just to be clear, I believe there's angels watching over you right now.
Amen.
But the idea here is he dispatched these two angels to come and bear witness to this truth that Jesus is alive from the dead. That's what they came to say. They were messengers from God. Their message is one of an absolute hope. It is one of perfect assurance, blessed assurance. Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory. When you come to this point in the story, you realize that although he died and his body was gone, she was mourning the loss. There was a foretaste of glory. Because what did the angel say? The angel said, woman, fear ye not, for I know that you're looking for Jesus. He was crucified. That same man that was crucified, this one that you love, this one that you've come looking for, oh God, just so you know, your eyes aren't deceiving you, he's not here. Today, most of us, yeah, right, I can see that. But he didn't stop there. He is not here, for he has risen just as he said. He's not here. He told you he was going to come. He said he would rise. Once in a while, we need something or someone, somehow, to affirm that what we've heard from the Lord, what we've read in the Bible, that it's true. We need to have this affirmation. The angels came, and they were just sitting there in the tomb. And it seems that they were there to give Mary that blessed, that calm assurance that Jesus was not stolen away in the night. But in reality, he's alive. She's weeping because she didn't understand this wonderful truth. It's as if they were asking, doesn't this empty tomb call instead for rejoicing? Maybe rather than crying, maybe you should be singing songs. Maybe you should be praising. Maybe you might want to be singing right now rather than crying. But Mary, like a lot of us, seems so determined to live by sight rather than to walk by faith. You know, we often fail to discover that deep spiritual blessing because we refuse to look beneath the surface to see what the Lord is trying so desperately to reveal to us. You know, he's pursuing you right now. Did you know that?
Amen.
As a matter of fact, he's in hot pursuit for you, for me. He so desires to reveal to us. So why can't he just, you know, just pop in? He's here right now. We've become so accustomed to what we have. Hot now, by the way. Where's the nearest hot now? What happened to them? They came, they went. And that's what happens quite often. Things come, they go. But there is someone that never leaves us, never forsakes us. And it seems that if we trust only our eyes, life is kind of like that, isn't it? So we see Mary, she was there. We see the angels, they were there. But wait a minute, what about Jesus? You might say, Pastor, he's gone. He's not there. See, she's there, and in Mary's confusion, in her weeping, she realizes that she isn't alone in the tomb. She wasn't even aware that the angels were there. She sees a man standing near her then as she gets up, and she doesn't really recognize this man because she's been crying. She's been crying so much that she can't see straight. Maybe that's the problem. Maybe that's why she couldn't see Jesus, because her eyes were full of tears and her vision was blurred and she couldn't see anything. I'm just blubbering and see. She continues to cry. And she becomes aware of a man standing next to her. Ain't that like us? Isn't it just like us? We have his promise. If she was going to believe her eyes at this point, there's a promise that we have in Hebrews. In the 13th chapter, and he makes his promise. He says, I will never
leave you.
I will never leave you. Forget the forsaken part. You left me. We have his promise. But like Mary, we fail to see him in our circumstances over and over again. We just don't see Jesus. All we see is our circumstances. He is a risen Savior, and he is always involved in what involves you. Did you hear that?
Amen.
Now, it's hard to believe because many of us, we're still doing things, we're still living our lives as if he doesn't live, as he doesn't exist, as if he's not with us. We pull up to our local establishments and we get out of the car and we say, Jesus, you stay in the car, I'll be out after a while. And you're hoping all the while that Jesus doesn't see how you acted while you were there. Where would that be? Could be anywhere. Maybe it was an in-law's house. Maybe it was a friend that you really didn't want to see today, but you want to see him anyway. You put on a good face, or you put on a good act. Why? Because you want to be just like you think. I want to make sure people think I'm this way. Well, that's a whole other message, isn't it? You know, if you look, you're always going to find that Jesus is there during your time of need. Amen?
Amen.
He's there. As a matter of fact, he's here. He is here. Hallelujah. He's here. Amen. So she's confused. And then Jesus confronts her. This is what he did. He confronted her. Jesus asked Mary two questions. He first says, "Why are you crying? What's the matter, child? Why are you crying? Why do you weep when you could be rejoicing? Seeking among the dead, why do you look for he that is alive among those who are dead?" You see, these questions are designed to remind Mary, and I'm hoping this morning that they remind us of a few things. That Jesus is the resurrection and the life in John 11:25. That he is the Prince of Life, Acts 3:12. That the one who laid down his life and has taken it up again in John 10:18, that's Jesus. He is the way, the truth, and the life. Why do you look for the living among the dead? So he's asking her these questions. She still hasn't quite caught on yet. But then there's that call, that personal call. What if I told you right now that he knows your name? And he's calling you by name. He called Mary by name. When Mary doesn't respond to his questions, he simply says, "Mary." Many of us were too distracted. We're distracted by the things around us. We're distracted by media. We're distracted by TV. We're distracted by this, that, and the other thing. And when he calls our name, what? Did somebody call my name? We don't know the response because we're not attuned to him. Because we're caught up in our own situation. Isn't it great to know that he knows your name? Isn't it great to know that he knows your name? And we hear in the scripture, and this is an indicator. Because Jesus says something in John 10:27. He says, "My sheep, they hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me." And it's an unusual message that we see, because Jesus now tells Mary to go tell the disciples that Jesus was alive and that he ascended back to the Father. But I'll be back later. I mean, it was to be a message of hope and a blessing to those who mourned his death. Go back and tell the disciples. Go back and tell the others. This kind of message was not delivered every day. It's a message that doesn't change. It never changes. that Jesus is alive. It's a message that says that he will never change. Listen to what Jesus tells us in Revelation 1:18. I am he that lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys of hell and of death. Can you give the Lord a hand clap of praises for him? Just to be clear, it's not just a message for just a few church folk. This message is for everyone. And the promise is for everyone. And the rewards are for everyone who would believe. I mean, we are still commanded to come and see. This is what we are still commanded, come and see, go and tell. You can write this down. This is the command of Christ himself. Come and see, go and tell. You come this morning to the Church of God in New Buffalo. What did you come to see? Whatever you came to see, now go and tell. You came to Jesus at one time in your life. Maybe you've gone to the Lord in prayer, and you maybe he revealed some things to you. He showed you some things. Now go and tell. Amen. Be a witness for Jesus. And let me tell you why. Because the world needs to hear from people who have been to the tomb, from people who have been in the gutters, from people who have been worn out, broke down, and busted. And they came to know that Jesus was alive, and he's now alive in them, and that now they can face tomorrow. Amen. Don't face tomorrow with Jesus. The world needs to hear of the Savior that we serve. Oh, we're really big about telling about the current events, and we're really big about jumping onto the media stuff that's out there about how bad things are. I had a conversation with some, I guess they were still friends, some people who were talking about, well, you know, this country is, I don't know what it's become. And can I tell you, if you're part of this country and you're saying it's become something, you're probably part responsible for that. And then, all right, I'm a little bit off topic, but not. Then the one or two guys in this group says, well, I didn't even vote. This is, there's your problem. You did vote by not voting. What are you doing? What are you doing? To make, oh, here you go. You've never heard this term. To make America great again. Just to be clear, I believe America is great. But America's going through some hard times. I believe that every nation and every people group on the planet, they have something to offer to our God and King. Their lives. The Bible says that we are to offer our lives as living sacrifices. Wouldn't it be great if the world could be a place where if Jesus came to visit, that when he left, he didn't say, I really didn't enjoy my stay here. Wouldn't it be great if we could come together at least on Sunday mornings and some other times where we gather together and the Holy Spirit's here and he's here right now. Can you feel him in his place? There's something that's on the bulletin talking about how was your experience with us today. You know, we hope that you were blessed and all this. How about we say, hey, Holy Spirit, are you enjoying your stay with us today?
Amen.
Welcome, Holy Spirit. See, there is a message that people need to hear, that everybody who comes to the tomb and sees that, listen, and they will place their faith in Jesus, Christ will save them from their sins and they can be born again. In all of recorded history, the most important message that has ever been heard is, he's not here. He's risen. He's not here. He's risen. And all the world around me, I see his loving care. No, I see that there's a lot of mess out there. You know, politicians and corporations have ruined the whole stuff. And all the world around me, I see his loving care. And though my heart grows weary, I will never despair. I know that he is leading through all the stormy blasts. The day of his appearing will come at last. Are you ready for his return?
Yes.
He lives, he lives. Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, he lives. Salvation to impart. You know, I'll be driving along in the car and I'll sing stuff like this. What songs are you singing? Has he not put a new song in your mouth? Let me just close with this. First off, altars are always open here. Many of you don't take advantage because you think, well, I prayed at home. I don't need to pray anywhere. Stop. Here's the problem. You want to see others pray? They need to see you pray. Mm-hmm. Seeing is believing. Wait, Pastor, you just told me that we walk by faith. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we need to see what it looks like to worship God. Let me ask you this morning. Do you know, not know of, do you know the risen Savior today? And are you trusting Jesus for your soul's salvation? And as Christians, are you going and telling other people? Well, they don't really want to hear. Tell them anyway. Because there was a time in your life you didn't want to hear either. But aren't you glad that the message of Christ just kept coming after you? Remember what I said earlier? That he's in hot pursuit. God is in hot pursuit of you. God is in hot pursuit of you and everyone that you know. He's in hot pursuit. Do you know Jesus this morning? And then if you know him, why am I? My goodness, why aren't you telling people? Perhaps it's because you're not living a life from someone who would talk about Jesus. What is it that they say about you? What is the image? Well, it doesn't matter what they think about me. Yes, it does. Do you want people to come to Christ? Then you might want to live as Christ. Be as Christ. Be holy, as the Bible says. Amen? Hallelujah. Let's worship. Remember, the tomb should be a place of rejoicing.
The sun.
And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 2,000 years and then forever.
He's come to set the captives free.
Yes.
He's come to loose the things that bind you. Amen. Listen to the words of this song.
Nobody Jesus, for who I'm meant to be. Thank you.
together to the Lord. Sister Linda, would you come forward? Hallelujah.
I really need a mic. I think my mouth is big enough. Okay, and everybody said amen. Amen. Right. Right. Be good if everybody stand that can. We understand that some can't, and that's fine, but stand in your heart, okay?
Amen.
And we thank Pastor for the word, and most of all, we thank the good Lord. And I love that, especially where he talked about the linens laying night, and he took time to do that, to let us know he didn't have to, but he wanted to. Yes. It was his purpose to come fulfill God's plan. And so the tomb is empty, and he's at the right hand of the Father, and he's in our hearts as well. So we thank you. We thank you for Patty and Gwen being here, blessing us with their presence today, and everybody else also. Father in heaven, we thank you today for your love and your mercy. We thank you for your many blessings.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you, O God, for your Son who was so willing to take our sins upon his life. But we thank you, Lord, most of all, he has set us free from those things, Father, and we ask him to come into our lives and forgive us, Father. We pray now as we go our separate ways, you watch over and protect us and keep us in your care, O God, and bring us back the next appointed time, Father, which is tonight at 6 o'clock. And I thank you for the privileges of being able to be in your house to share your word, Father,
yes, Lord.
And hear your word. Help us to go out now, as Pastor has said, come see it and then go tell it. So help us to be good stewards of your word also, Father. And we thank you for the food that we're about to receive, Lord, in the fellowship hall during our time of fellowship. We thank you for those that prepared food, Lord, and those that, Lord, donated towards the foods. And we ask, Lord, you bless them, Lord, and meet the needs in their lives and meet the needs in the lives of the homeless and hungry and in our loved ones' lives also. In Christ's holy name, amen, amen.
Amen.